We've prepared something a little special for you.
Okay.
There are a bunch of Audi jokes. And this is my little touch too. Are we recording? How's the audio? Joke number one.
Go on.
Long way to go, long way to go. My music makes me so hard, makes me say. Before we got you on this show, we actually had to audition a bunch of other people. Could you move a little that side? Just a little. Could you
Why?
Move? Just a little. Get a little space between. Wanna move the cameras? Just a little more, if you don't mind. Since we're so far apart, am I audible?
Are you guys really doing this?
Shut up. Are you having fun?
Yeah.
Pretty sure the audience at home are also having fun. Shut up. My favorite place to perform, like in the whole of India?
Auditorium. Okay. Next.
A Christ University.
Yes, fine.
He beat me.
Beat.
Beatbox.
We are doing the interview. Can you please call us back later? We are doing an interview. Can you please call us back later?
He doesn't answer English. He speaks in some foreign language. I mean, understand.
What? See? Okay, Mone. Bye.
That's how you deal with a problem. My problem is called Adishesh Sunil.
The reason why I'm called Audi is not because I wanted it to be cool.
Wait. Before that, he is not Bengali. He's not Bengali, he's Kannadiga, right?
Yes.
And a lot of people actually message me saying, hey, your friend Audi, is he actually Bengali? Because it's A-U-D-I, Auditya.
Yeah.
We're gonna break that stereotype right now. Misconception.
Yes.
It's a misconception. Bad use of the English language.
Can I explain my name now?
Yeah, please explain
so
your name.
My name is spelled E-U-D-I-T-Y-A.
Because his dad's a damn funny man.
Yes, he is. Let me put this back on. I took it out at disappointment. Yes.
For the seriousness.
He just thought it would be a cool name. A few years ago, he told me why. This is after I dropped out from Chartered Accountancy. The joke basically goes that he wanted me to be an auditor. So he put audit in my name. What a troll my dad is.
Why do you travel?
Travel is the way I experience the world. The most important part of my life is my family, and most of my memories of my family from my childhood are around our travels.
Yeah.
My dad used to be in a traveling job.
That's so where you clicked your first picture also.
In Kodaikanal.
Kodaikanal.
One of those trips.
But how old were you?
8.
Okay.
Whenever he came to Bangalore from the estates, he would just take us off for a trip. Just the family memories are always in travel, so which is why I enjoy traveling the most. In fact, as a family, we still travel together. We make it a point to do a road trip or two every 2-3 months.
Okay. Initially, when we started our career, we used to go to all our gigs on your bike, right?
This is even before you could ride.
No, I could ride.
No.
I could ride.
Pretty badly.
I've been riding, but I've been riding since I was 16. So I was about 20, 21.
Yeah.
I was 21.
No, but it was just getting polished with the Discover
maybe,
at that time.
Yeah. Maybe, yeah.
Probably you weren't riding as much, but you knew how to ride.
I knew how to ride.
Yeah.
We used to do all our gigs on a bike.
Yeah.
That's also because we were on a budget.
Yeah.
And one of my first memorable bike trips was when we rode from Chennai
to Mahabalipuram.
Yeah. We were watching Top Gear the previous night. There were two parts. First part and second part where the three of them go to Vietnam.
Vietnam,
we got
yes.
these stupid bikes. And we all looked at each other and said, we have to get ourselves bikes.
Let's find ourselves a bike rental in Chennai.
In Chennai, which was one of the most difficult things in 2012.
And such bad bikes.
Such bad bikes. His bike, we had to actually run behind his Pulsar. We had to push his Pulsar.
Jump start.
You had a Pulsar.
Did I?
Yeah, you had a Pulsar. Okay. Very beaten down
Who
Pulsar.
Had a Splendor? You had a Splendor.
I had the Splendor.
Okay.
You wanted the Pulsar because it was a lot faster. I wanted the I didn't want the Splendor. I just got the Splendor because you gave it to me. And we had to push his bike and we couldn't stop his bike because the first gear was really weird. And he had to jump on the bike while the bike was moving. And we did Chennai to Mahabalipuram at what?
Thanks a lot.
We did Chennai to Mahabalipuram at 2, 3 in the morning?
Yeah, 2, 3 in the morning we got.
And we reached at 5.
No. We got there at 3:30.
Said everything would be open. Who was that?
Anish.
He said, bro, I've been to Mahabalipuram, bro. Everything's open, bro, all the time, bro.
So what ended up happening was, it's just one of those impulse decisions that you make that, you know, let's just go on this.
It was a good one.
It was good, but we ended up in Mahabs with absolutely no hotel bookings and nothing was open.
Mm.
You know where we stayed? A wedding chowdhury.
We stayed in a highly questionable wedding chowdhury because that was the only thing open at 5 in the morning, 4:30 in the morning. Because we got chased out from the beach. They didn't let us sleep on the beach. There were a couple of cops.
Yeah.
So we were riding around. We finally found a guy sitting outside a wedding chowdhury. He said, come, we'll give you a room. And got some $500, $600 we paid for a room. But we could not sleep in that room because number one, it had bed bugs. Number two, the sheets were stained with what we thought was blood.
Yeah.
Where?
What very we thought possibly was blood. Blood. Yeah.
So. Highly possibly.
So, I mean, I stayed out of the room. I don't think I even sat on the bed. So, yeah, but that's basically.
You didn't sleep at all. No. I tried sleeping. You didn't sleep at all.
I couldn't sleep in
there. And then we went to this breakfast place in the morning and we were ordering all meat based stuff.
Yeah. Oh,
and, yeah. We were the first people on that beach.
Yeah. It's down the road from Moonrakers. This is like the last. Yeah. Restaurant on the right hand side on that Moonrakers road, and all these guys ordered stuff. And then I asked him,
he's looking at the menu, there's nothing that's vegetarian on the menu. He's vegetarian.
Yes,
the guy he looks up after we're done with our order and he asks the waiter, do you have anything that's vegetarian?
And he says, what?
The waiter looks at the three of us and says, what is that?
Vegetarian? Yeah,
what is vegetarian? And we all burst out laughing.
And then he said, I'll cut some tomatoes and give it to you, you can eat it or something
with
like
some
that.
Bread. Yeah. With some bread,
some bread,
and
which funnily was my breakfast.
We have done quite a few trips together also. We have done the first ever thing that we call the beetroot back in 2011 when I just finished college. And we decided to take a few of the artists, have a predefined tour and perform at these different places. And this was with Make a Difference. This was with Make a Difference and we did this place called a Seven Beans Cafe in Hubli.
Such good Maggie.
Oof.
Such good Maggie.
Different kinds of Maggie. We had four types of Maggie at that place, right? And then there was what other places did we do? We visited.
So the first we went to was Mysore. Then we went to Coorg.
Yeah.
At Coorg is where we went to the school.
Yeah.
In the evening and night we spent time with the kids there and they performed for us and
we performed for them.
And they performed as well, right?
They did.
From there we went to.
We went
Mangalore.
Coorg. We stayed the night in Coorg, which was beautiful. Yeah. We woke up in the morning. Ah, that was amazing.
That was with Glenn, Bhairav, and Nakul.
Nakul. And then we went to Mangalore. Did we do a gig in Mangalore?
Yeah, at the Make a Difference shelter home. Yeah, that's when you had the speakers in the car and then we turned it around. And
there were two gigs I think we did in Mangalore.
Yeah,
two different gigs. From there we went to Manipal, met a bunch of people. And from Manipal we went to Gokarna.
Just before that we stopped at Kapu.
Kapu!
Which is where you got extremely sick. He couldn't stop throwing up.
And the other guy couldn't stop pooping. It was one of the worst things ever. And we decided to go to Goa, but we had to stop at Gokarna. At about 12:30 in the night. And again, we found problems with accommodation.
The problem was that the shacks were booked out. Such crazy experiences.
Mm. All on super tight budgets.
All on super tight budgets.
So we didn't let money stop us from traveling back in the day. I don't think we let it stop us even now.
I don't think so.
No.
For me, driving is the best way to get anywhere.
Mm.
But just in the interest of time, if it takes me longer than 8 or 9 hours to drive to somewhere, then I fly it. But if it's under, I'd rather drive it there than do anything. One is because I have the tendency to miss things. So I've missed quite a few flights, buses, trains, you name it.
Last one being last night.
Last night,
when you were supposed to come and meet us, but I missed that flight.
Missed the flight last night, so I had to move it to this morning.
You missed a lot of flights, right?
Yeah.
Quite a few.
I don't want to put a number on it.
Thankfully, if there's any wood, touch that, I haven't missed a single flight as of yet. Not a single train, not a single flight, not a single bus.
Never say never.
Which is why I did that.
Yeah, for me, driving is just the best way to experience it. I used to ride a lot. I mean, like we were talking earlier, I used to enjoy riding, but it's really unpredictable. Because you back your skill on a bike and go, but then you never really know what's at the end of the road. And I guess that's what you need to be prepared for as anybody on roads. You need to be always be on the sort of lookout for something. Which is when I got a car, which is 2012, I stopped riding entirely. And I probably haven't ridden in a long time.
You sold your bike, your first ever bike. Who'd you sell it to?
Somebody knew my place.
So when you're driving by car, to most of your gigs, to most of your work, what are the things you look out for? Pros, cons, the good things, the bad things.
First and the most important thing that a lot of people overlook is making sure your car's in proper shape. So if I have to do a drive that's longer than maybe 200 or 250 kilometers, I make sure that I've had it at least serviced properly. I have a tire inflator in my car. I have a puncture kit in my car. I have a vacuum cleaner in my car. I have an emergency lamp in my car. I make sure all my tools are in my car, my spare tires proper. I make sure all these things are fine. My lights are working, my wiper blades. I make sure all of these things are working before I even set out on a road trip. And my tires, most importantly, because a lot of times you're lucky if you just pick up a puncture, but if on a highway, because of the heat, if it blows up and stuff, then you're in quite a lot of trouble. There's no coming back from that. Secondly,
it's not getting enough of sleep, because you don't get enough of sleep.
Luckily, I don't feel sleepy when I'm behind the wheel, but I never push myself to a point where I question if I can stay up through the drive, because that's not a good thing to do. You always want to be alert. At any point, if I even feel my mind is drifting slightly, you black out about the last part of the distance that you've done. And that's my sort of first sign of being tired, and find a place to crash if I'm sleepy.
Find a place to sleep, not to crash.
Sleep, sorry.
So don't that's be an idiot.
Yeah.
Look out for the signs, be smart.
And I do tend to drive fast, but well within my limits and not exceeding too much of what the limits on the roads are. India has beautiful highways, but there's a reason we have...
I don't know if that's sarcasm. Is that
sarcasm? No, beautiful highways. I drove from Kanyakumari to Kashmir and back last year, 13,000 kilometers. I didn't have a single puncture, I didn't have a single incident. Not one puncture. The thing is, there's a reason we have speed limits, there's a reason we have all these different signs put up, suddenly asking you to slow down to 20 kilometers an hour, and you don't expect it, but those are the things that they've put there for a specific reason.
Okay.
Because we were going through this one part where the roads are still, it's a four-lane road. Right, it just narrows down slightly. It said 30 kilometers an hour because it was 80 till a while ago and it says 30. We were wondering why somebody would do something, and we were probably 10 or 15 kilometers over that limit. Just then, out of nowhere, a tractor just comes like this and goes the other way. So if we were 80, that's how we would have even missed that whole situation and just gone into that guy. So that's another thing that I always pay attention to. I mean, you may be extremely confident in being able to drive your car at whatever speed, but like I was saying earlier, it's the combination of everybody on the road. If you do decide to drive at night, make sure you're driving on roads that have markings, reflectors, signages. If you don't, then I don't think it's worth the risk, because you have the chance of running into other vehicles that are unmarked, animals, and a lot of these other things.
I would always say don't ride or drive during twilight. That's a very confusing time.
I drive at day at night, I have no problems.
No, like twilight, right? No. It's just shifting from day to night. You okay with that?
I have no problem.
My eyes tend to go for a little more. What I'm doing.
Get it checked, because when you wore my glasses, you said you could see properly.
Midpoint, it's a lie.
But yeah, basically just be safe and always be alert. If at any point you feel yourself drifting and you think you're losing focus, then just don't do it. Another thing I do, just make sure I have all my documents. I mean, the cops are doing their job. Some are good, some are not that good. But if you're on the right side of the law, the cops that I talk to usually say this, is you have no need to be scared if you've done everything right. And if I have all my papers, if a cop stops me, I have no reasons to be worried about why he's stopping me. So that's another thing that I always make sure. And just as an additional precaution, I always have a dash cam on the highways. And I record my entire trip just for documenting the whole thing. No, so basically what it does is, the dash cam that I have keeps deleting footage by itself, but it's activated by a gyroscope. So anytime there's a sudden jerk or a bump, it starts saving that as a emergency recording, and it doesn't delete that.
Okay.
So if at all there's an incident, This is just as a documentation, whether you're in the right or the wrong, but you have a documentation of exactly what happened. So later, if you need it for your whatever reasons, you have it. You got what you would consider in Indian standards an extremely powerful bike.
In Indian standards, I'm very Indian because I think it is quite powerful.
Yeah. Another thing that I do is if I don't know the vehicle or I'm spending some time on it, I always make sure I'm going slow, know everything's working on that vehicle.
And test the tires, test the brakes.
Test everything, yeah.
Ticket for a little spin and before you actually do your ride, which you did.
Always wear your helmets.
Always
wear your helmets. Today I had to ride in shorts because I just arrived from the airport, but I wouldn't ideally do that. I was just being extremely cautious and safe. So just, you know what the right thing to do is, just make sure you do it.
He was in beach mode.
Yeah, I came from Bangalore, just like, that's why I look like this.
Can't touch this, Audi photography. 1, 2, 3, 4. My music makes me so hard, makes me say, oh my lord, thank you lord for blessing me with a mind too hot, but too hot feet, that's good. And I know you're down, a super dope homeboy from the old town in the moon. As such, and this is a beat you can't touch. Can't touch this. Can't touch this. Can't touch this.
Just dance. God. 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 God